Our time is short. Not in life right now. I hope you didn't hate me after the last session. But I think it's... I would have done harm if I didn't present it this way. Because it is the truth. So do you remember the six deadly viruses? Number one is selfishness. Number two, hastiness and superficiality. Number three, sexual immorality or freedom. Number four, materialism, money. Number five, addiction. Number six is atheism. And we took the model of the tabernacle. For the sake of the time, we are not going to repeat. But if you remember, the tabernacle is a white linen surrounding the tabernacle. The entrance is done in a fabric different than the fabric of the tabernacle or the rest of the tabernacle perimeter. And we learned, or we spoke about 10 lessons. We spoke about 10 lessons we will focus on as a 10 commandment from the Lord to our families. The first lesson is build the structure. We need to have a spiritual structure in our homes. And our anything I'm speaking about, first start with yourself, then start with the family. It will be very awkward if I'm telling my kids to pray and I'm not praying. It will be even more awkward if I'm asking them to read in the Bible and I'm not reading in the Bible. It will not be genuine. It will not be going through. So first, we need to have to build a spiritual structure. I have seen many people who have done custom homes. And they call Abuna and please Abuna, come and pray for us because we have done a very nice home. And really what inspired me in two families that they had created a third level in their home, that they kept it as a church. It's very, very tiny, small, little church, or a place for prayer, or even if I'm living in an apartment, you can have a small wall on the as a place where you are. This is icon for the Lord or Saint Mary, and this is the place where you pray. So dedicating a structure is very important on a schedule level and also physical structure that we go to pray. I was in a visit before priesthood to a close friend of mine. And we stayed. We had a very nice time together. Then I am leaving. And he told me, we didn't pray together. So I told him, okay, don't bring me. Let us pray. So he told me, okay, come over. And he took me. And they had, if you have it's exactly like you have a pantry that they didn't use it as a pantry, but they kept it as this is the prayer room. And it's full of icon, and it felt completely, completely different when he took me by hand and we went in this pantry, that it was a prayer room. And we prayed together, I remember, maybe the sixth or the ninth hour. The whole point is, when you have a structure on a level of physical structure, when you have a structure, spiritual, schedule, it's all about timing. I know that every one of us is extremely busy. If I looked on your Google calendars right now, booked, back to back, everything is back to back. If it is not on your calendar, it is not in your life. If prayer and reading in the Bible is not on your calendar, it is not in your life. As simple as that. We keep saying, it's nice to pray. Link it. We need to have a spiritual structure that it is built on a physical level and also in the same time on a calendar level. It's crucially important to put it in the calendar. One of the nice exercises of doing this, adding an alarm on your phone. Or linking prayer in the morning with coffee. I'm not going to take coffee except whenever I'm before praying. Or I will never watch TV after dinner without reading in the Bible. Link it to something that you always do every day. 1 hour of, when you have a break, I remember a person whom I know, the lunch hour is distributed in 20 minutes, 20 minutes, 20 minutes. First 20 minutes praying in the Agbe and reading in the Bible. Second 20 minutes, he's eating. Third 20 minutes, he's replying the phone calls and the emails and the people who tried to reach him when he was in work. We need to have a structure. We need to build a structure. Number two is set clean and pure boundaries. Set clean and pure. We need to live a life of purity that is modeled to the kids. I had statistics before, but I don't have it right now on top of my mind or in the presentation. But above more than 60 or 70 million families in the U.S. that they have kids. So they know from the cable channels. They signed up for kids channels. And in the same time, they are signing up for adult channels. And the whole message is you think or that you are, you know, but the kids are not going to watch this or are not going to be exposed to this. They are much smarter than us. They are on top of things more than us. And they will go in whatever you have in your system, whether a laptop or whatever is the entity that you are using for movies. Or we need to live a pure life. The magazines that are inappropriate, don't bring it or don't buy it. Even if you think that it is not going to affect the kids, and a very common comment, they are going to see it anywhere. They are going to see it anywhere and anyway. What's a big deal? You have an answer for this? They are going to see it anywhere. So it's no big deal. They're going to get exposed to this anyway. So bringing it in my home, I'm accepting even something like this. But what else? There is a much more serious result of this. Have you seen any concrete that is being poured when they pour the concrete and it is still wet? What will happen when you step in this concrete when it is still wet? It will print, and this print will stay for how long? Forever. This is exactly what is happening in the life of the kids. If they are exposed to inappropriate material early age, it is imprinted in their life for life, in their memory for life. And this is what people who are creating those types of websites, they are targeting kids. In an interview that ex-FBI director was looking after the inappropriate websites online, he said this, that those who are developing the websites know one idea in their mind. If they hook the kids early in age, they got them for life. So what they do, they know, for example, 12 years old, they are searching for whatever very famous singer or very, very famous game or sports or whatever. So they know the maximum number of hits, it's coming from this age group. So they link their ads about inappropriate sites to this search. So once the kids are searching, for example, for Disneyland, once Disneyland is being imprinted on Google, this ad is coming up because they know that this age is searching for this and they capture this age. Are you there? Are you following me? To that extent, it is really very evil. So we need to protect our families and to protect our life and set a very clean and clear boundaries with the things that we see and the things that we say and the things that we buy and we invest in. Number one, set a clear structure. Number two is set clean and pure boundaries. Number three, the door. If you remember, the door was done out of a fabric different than the other premises. The door, Christ is the beginning, the way, and the end. And if God is the beginning of everything, so He should be the beginning in our days. He should be the beginning before we make decisions. He should be the beginning in the things that we choose or the things that we pursue, the way, and in the end also, He is the destination. So if God is the door, then God should be the beginning in every single thing we do. Number four, which is a very important thing, once you enter from the door, you find the altar that you offer a sacrifice on that altar. And there are three sacrifices that needs to be offered. The ego, the me, my will, and my comfort. Because if you remember, the first problem was self-centeredness and selfishness and everything. It is all about me. I want this and I... Very common. I don't know whether Abuna have seen this or not. But this is very, very, very common answer. Someone is having a major problem and a family member is calling me. And whether this problem is in marriage or in addiction or in big legal issue. And the first thing I ask the person who is calling, is this young man or young woman listen to anyone? There is anyone who is closer to them that they can guide them? And what is the answer? No one. They only listen to themselves. Very common answer. They only listen to themselves. Unfortunately, this is what happens when we are full of ourselves and think that we are on the right path. In a Christ-centered family where God is in our midst, I should offer my ego, my pride, on the sacrifice or the altar of sacrifice on every single day. This is a real story that happened with me personally, or a real event. Every time I go to Egypt, there is an old lady, she is very short, not less than 80 years old, attending. She's a widow attending all the liturgies. So after I finish the liturgy and I'm leaving, she calls me, Abuna, I want to tell you something. Because she's a little bit short, so I told her, yes, don't tell me what you want to tell me. And she whispers in my ears and tells me, for your sake, we die all day long. For your sake, we die all day long. This is a Bible verse in the book of Romans chapter 8. For your sake, we die all day long. So I told her, okay, so what shall I do with this Bible verse? She just looks to me in the eye and smiles and leave. It happened with me 3 years consecutive. Every year I'm going, I met this old lady and she's telling me the same Bible verse. Then I said, definitely God is sending me a message. I don't know what is this message, but it is a very important message. And have you been ever dealing with people who are annoying in your life? If you have been dealing with people who are annoying, raise your hand. You haven't dealt with any people who are annoying? People who are, push your buttons? Whether, I'm not speaking about family members, but just normally people that really, really triggering you. And every time a person is triggering you, you have two options. Whether to get back and be mean again or rebuke them and let them know what they are doing wrong, or let go. When you let go, because this is again is your first impression, again is your first instinct, in a very simple way, this is putting, for your sake we die all day long, this is putting your will to death. Because you want to do something and you are not doing it for the sake of God, not for the sake of being nice or being courteous or being decent or being Ibn Anas or being... No, it's for the sake of doing it for the sake of God. Because so every time you are sacrificing your own will, you are saying as St. Paul, or you are applying this with St. Paul, for your sake we are dying all day long. We are dying all day long. And it is not easy. It is not easy. So the bronze altar offers the sacrifice of your ego, and or of your will, and also your comfort. In many, many times, the problem is I am thinking that, you know what, it's all about me resting and me having peace and me having fun. But this is also a true situation. A guy top-notch in his career. Very successful, very decent, very nice guy. He created a small area in his home where he has a huge flat screen TV, a recliner chair, and the glass door that is locked, that locks from inside only. And this is the scenario. He goes home around 8, 9 p.m. Hi to his wife. How are you, kids? Everything's okay? Okay, I'm sorry. I need to go to my room. He goes to the room, locks himself in, stay on the recliner, watch TV all night, goes back out of his room after he is done or everyone is asleep, sleeps, goes to the work second day and so forth. When we are running after our comfort and just to rest and just to have our own good time, unfortunately, this is building up a lot of bitterness and hatred and anger and frustration in the hearts of the people who are around you. Do not take your rest or your comfort from the comfort of others. You, and this is very common. A boy telling me, you know what, mom is beside the fridge and she's yelling at me when I'm watching TV and she's telling me, bring me a cup of water. This is weird. I mean, you are in front of the fridge and I am watching this TV, whatever. She is not mindful of making him move about or not to have a long screen time. She is obsessed with her needs and making all the home, the kids and the husband or the kids and the wife, it's all about my comfort. We need, if we want really to reach the Holy of the Holies, we need to go from the beginning, have a spiritual structure. Number two, set clean and pure boundaries. Enter through the door, which is Christ. Offer your will, your ego, and your comfort on the sacrifice. And by this, you are on the right path. The second thing is living a life of repentance, getting washed always. One of the best scenarios, one of the best incidents that I have heard here in the U.S., a guy told me this. He used to call Abuna and book 5 appointments together. In the beginning, Abuna was feeling weird. What's 5 appointments back to back? He told him, yes, me and my wife and my 3 kids are coming to confess. What will be the imprint in the memory of the kids that we as a family are going to Abuna to? It is, did you confess? As if confession is for the little kids, you need to confess to Abuna. And they haven't seen me going and practicing the sacrament of confession. We need to live a life that is modeling this. And without getting cleansed, we will not be able to enter. The problem is that we are not, every one of us, even if we are the righteous falls 7 times every day and rise again. So we need to live a life of repentance. And this is the lever step. The lamp, when you enter the holy, there are 3 things. You remember the 3 things in the holy? Are you still awake? The lampstand, the table of showbread, and the altar of incense. The lampstand, it is a lamp full of oil. A lamp full of oil. Fill your lamp with the oil of good deeds. Do you remember the 6th category in Matthew 25 when the Lord was speaking about in the end of days, you have been, I was naked and you clothed me and I was imprisoned and you visited me and I was hungry and you fed me and I was thirsty and you gave me to drink. The 6 categories, they are all works of good deeds, services or things that we do for others. Maybe you don't know anything about Coptic. Maybe you have no clue about much about what is in the Old Testament and the symbols of Christ in the Old Testament. And maybe you have nothing to do with the hymns and the liturgies. But we cannot stand in front of God and we have people who are in need around us and we are shutting down and we are not helping. Or who are saying, you know what, I'm not going to help anyone. There was a person who is in bad, bad need. And I asked some of the people whom I know, and I told them, without mentioning the names, there is a situation, this is a situation, and we need this amount of help. And it was not only financial, but it was a lot of time-consuming material or need. And the guy texted me in the end and told me, he did everything and he told me, this is one drop of oil. This is one drop of oil. After all the effort that he did. So I told him, what oil are you talking about? And he told me, do you remember the five foolish virgins and the five wise virgins? The five wise, they collected the oil all their life. So he is telling me all this effort that I did, it's just one drop of oil. I'm just mindful. This was his model of his life. He is mindful of collecting oils, doing things for the sake of the love of God. And it is very inspiring when we live our life to give. This is also a true situation. Two friends of mine living in overseas, working very hard, making a lot of money, their kids high school and college age, and they said, you know what, we are going to give the kids the best thing ever. They booked Disney hotel in Paris, flight tickets, full of activities. I mean, they spent a fortune on this trip. And they said, this is the dream trip for the kids. After 3 nights, the kids are bored. And I remember the guy, he was going to have a heart attack. Literally, he was going to have a heart attack. He paid a huge amount of money. And he couldn't believe that the kids, after all of this, they are bored after 3 days. So we had a long discussion and I told him, next year, service trip in Kenya or Africa. Forget about this this fancy, fun approach with the kids. They are full of fun anyway. They are full of things that have been, it's all about entertainment. Did you have fun today? 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 It's self-centeredness. Did you have fun today? Did it feel good? This is not the goal. Next year, they arranged, they didn't go to Kenya, they went to South Africa. They stayed 3 weeks. All of them, they were service. Maybe they had 1 or 2 days enjoying the trips and safari there. And the parents said that this is the best thing that they have done for their kids since they were very little. It changed their life. The whole point, we are obsessed of giving, thinking that, you know what, or securing or protecting an environment that they have fun. But the whole point is, yes, when they have fun, but they get bored easily. They are not thankful. They are bragging about the stuff that they have done. They are fighting against things that they didn't get or other people had. And the whole point is we are missing out on the main goal is to go outside of yourself. So the lamp will fill your lamp with the oil of good deeds, as it says in Matthew chapter 5. Number 7, incense always prayer. The altar of incense is on all day long, all night long. There is incense all the time because it is a life of prayer. We need to have a life of prayer. And this is the gift that the first 10 families that they will finish the mission statement. Tomorrow we'll have a mission statement. So today we'll give you a discovering my values sheet. I hope that you do it wholeheartedly. It's very, very important. You do it on a personal level. This is my value, my values. Fill it in. It is very simple. Place 8 chosen values on the lines to the left. There is no tricks. You are not going to lose any one of your family. And there is no boat. It's just very simple, direct sheet. So fill in your family, your personal values. And let your spouse fill in your personal values. Go through them together. And if they are different, which is obviously will happen, try to think of what are the things that we, both of us, value the more, or what are the things that you will not let go. For example, whatever is the value that you really care for and say, you know what, this is This is it. I cannot let go of this. Because this is going to help you tomorrow in the exercise for finishing the or doing the family mission statement. We'll go through it step by step. So the first 10 families that they will finish there, if you did this and you are ready, the mission statement exercise will be very easy. And you can go through it very quickly. Yes, we can distribute it, but yeah, there's no time for doing it right now because we are in a rush. So just one for each person. It is very, very helpful exercise that you can know exactly what is really important for you. So a life of prayer, the gift is related to the life of prayer in the family. It's a very, very, I hope it's a very, very nice gift. Number 8 is bread and manna. The table of showbread and the manna in the Ark of Covenant is a symbol for or pointing to the Eucharist sacrament. And without being one with God, how we are going to be one with each other and how our kids are going to be one with God as well. I cannot forget a story about a man leaving Christianity. He called Abuna and he told him, I just want to let you know that tomorrow is my last day to be a Christian and I'm not coming anymore to a church and I'm converting to a different religion. So Abuna told him, can I see you after the liturgy? And he told him, you know what, it doesn't make any difference, but I will come. Abuna was praying for this young man all the day and in the liturgy. The man came earlier, maybe 10, 15 minutes earlier. He saw Abuna standing in the place where he's giving communion to the kids. And he finished the liturgy. And Abuna told him, okay, wait for me for a few minutes and I will come back to you. You know the veil of the altar? So he did this. He's standing outside of the veil, and he put his head back, and he kept looking to the altar, and he stayed in this situation or in this phase for 20 minutes. And Abuna didn't do anything. He was waiting for him in the church, and when he finished, he turned back and went to Abuna. He was full of tears. So Abuna told him what's going on, and he told him, this young man told Abuna, for the past 30 years I haven't entered church, but when I came today and I saw the kids taking communion, the little kids, I remembered myself being in the same place, in the same location, taking communion 30 years back, and how I went really extreme away from God, and now I want to return back, and I want to repent, and I want to change my life. When we are united with God on the level of the taking communion, it's a completely different level of unity, because you are united with God and God is in you and is in your family members. It's very, very important to be mindful of this, especially going early to liturgy, Number 9 is the tablet. When you enter to the Holy of the Holies, there is the two tablets of the Ten Commandments of the Lord. And the two tablets is the commandment of God. And the two tablets is the scripture in my life. Where do really I put emphasis and effort in my relationship with God on the level of the scripture? In many situations, I remember speaking with one of the youth who had a very long debate about homosexuality, very long debate for months. He was not convinced. Every time I'm telling him about that this is not, you are not born like this, he cannot get it. So we had a meeting and I told him, you know what, I'm not going to talk with you about this topic again. And in that time, I had a PowerPoint presentation about what does the Bible says about homosexuality. So I opened the laptop and I told him, you know what? Forget about what I'm telling you. Forget about everything. Just you read out loud. We open the computer. You read out loud what the Bible is saying. And if it is Boules's personal opinion, then to just trash it. Recycle bin. Forget about it. But if it is the God's commandment, then there is a completely different. 1 Corinthians 6:9 was one of the very powerful verses about homosexuality. You should be keeping record of this because it says very clearly about that this is a deception. And God cannot judge anyone who has a green eyeball or a blue eyeball because he doesn't like them. You are born like this, then God is not going to judge you on something that you don't have control over. Are you there? So because the whole point is homosexual, you are born like this. When you are born like this, if God is not going to judge you about something that you are born with, then it's over. If you return back to 1 Corinthians 6:9, or do you not know that wrongdoers will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived. Neither sexual immoral, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor men who have sex with men, nor thieves, nor the greedy, nor the drunkards, nor the slanderers, nor the swindlers will inherit the kingdom of God. It can't be more clear than this. It's very, very clear. And you can have your own interpretation on whatever you have. But if the word of God is dwelling in us richly, forget about my personal opinion and your personal opinion, but let us return back to what the Bible is saying. And after this, the last slide that showed this verse, I told him, I'm not going to talk with you, but I will be praying for you, and that's it. And it took this young person almost six months. Then I knew that he returned back to church and he trusted in the word of God more than he trusted in his own mindset. And in many situations, just the commandment or the scripture is very, very powerful, and it's like two-edged sword that goes deep inside of us that really makes us discern with what is right and what is wrong. Last but not least, Aaron's rod. Do you remember what happened with Aaron's rod? It budded, but what happened? What was the problem? What was the problem for Aaron's? You remember? Yeah, everyone said, you know, why Aaron? Why Abuna David should be the one who is taking the Sharia and doing like this? I can do it. If I'm not Abuna, I can do it. And I can offer the sacrifice, and I can. It's no big deal. And why God is discriminating us and he's not picking us and choosing us? So God asked Moses that all the tribes will bring, every tribe will bring one rod from their tribes, and told them that the rod that I will choose is the rod that is chosen. And this is God's choice. So Aaron's rod is always choosing God's way. Because in many situations we are confused and we don't know what to do. And because we don't know what to do, we are confused and we are left clueless. What is next, or what can I do, or how can I change things? So I will tell you how the decision-making process is happening. There is a story about a black bag in the park. Think of this. You are walking nearby next to your room, your house, or your place that you live in, and you found a big black bag that is full of cash dollars. It has $60,000 cash. You looked around. No one is there. You took a deep breath. And then I am asking you what you are going to do. the story is, my question is done. What are you going to do? You're not going to do anything with the money? Turn it to the police, okay? Anyone is going to take the money? 40 years ago? Can you tell me why? Why your decision changed? Okay, so the $60,000 is not going to help you out. And if it is $2,000, $100,000? Okay. Okay. Yeah, take it and give it to the poor. Okay. Okay, even God took the coin from the fish. So you are saying to take the 60,000, the 60 grand, and yeah, maybe. Yeah, yes. Yeah, your lucky day. Any other ideas? It wasn't earned. Do you earn everything that you have? What about the lottery? Now we're going to the lottery. Don't go in the lottery now. This is a completely different topic. Okay. Any other ideas? So police, give it to the poor. God already took the coin from the belly of the fish, so. It's no, I should take it. Wait till I see somebody is claiming it. Okay. Take it and share it with somebody. Okay. One of the funniest answers was, I will take the bag and throw it up. If it is God's, he will take it. If it fell, I will take the money. Okay, any other answers? Give it to the church. Do you think that the church will take it from you? I'm just wondering. Don't give it all at once. 1,000 every month. So in 5 years, we'll get the 60 grand. Okay. Okay, invest it, then whatever comes out of it, I will give it to the church, but I will keep the 60. Everything, including the... Okay. A better decision for the church. Okay. An important setting, yes. Why should I be in this? It has depend on your spiritual life, your spiritual relationship with God, your spirituality. Okay. Okay. Okay, it depends on your spiritual level. Any other creative ideas? None? Okay. Actually, I'm not answering the question. But I'm just telling you how you did this question quickly, how the answer played a role. Look, our reactions or our decisions is based on, first, your belief. Second, your values. Third, your behaviors and your decisions. Again, our behavior is based on what you believe in, then what you value, then the decisions and the behaviors will happen automatically. So if I believe that I cannot take anything that I am not earning, and I value what? My belief is, I cannot, if it is not earned, it is not mine. Because I value hard work. So I'm making a decision, I'm not taking it. If I believe that it is not safe out there, and there is a lot of gangs, a lot of bad people out, and I value what? My life or my safety. So I make the decision based on my values and my belief. If I believe that love, life is an opportunity, and if opportunity knocks on the door, you need to take it. Because I value what? What? Opportunity or advancement in my life, then the decision will be different. And the whole point, I'm just giving you an example, not to answer the question, but to tell you where each one's mindset went to. Based on your belief, based on your values, based on those two, the decision is happening. But this is not the end of this slide. Who I am is also determining big time our belief, our values, and our decisions, our identity. I will give you an example. Have you heard about about Prince William in UK? He went to McDonald's. It was a big deal. The helicopters of the news are videotaping the McDonald's, and they are recording the prince eating in McDonald's. It's a big deal. Why? It's a big deal. So because of who he is, his identity. He's from the royal family. You are eating junk food. It's not aligning. Who you are is not aligning with what you are doing. Are you there? Who you are is not aligning with what you are doing, but if who you are is aligning with what you are doing, then it's very normal. If a gang leader is smoking cigarette, does this create any question mark? It's no big deal. A gang leader is smoking cigarette or pot. It's no big deal. That you find a deacon lead smoking pot, it's very awkward. It doesn't match up with who you are. So our identity is very, very, very important in playing major roles in our belief, in our values, in our decisions. And the whole point is sometimes we are obsessed with our kids, and even in churches, don't do this, do this. Don't do this, do this. Don't do this, do this. We are working where? On the behavior and the decision. Where is the value? Where is the belief? Where is the identity? My point is, if all my life, it's all about do's and don'ts, do's and you should, and you should, you should, and you should, you should, and you shouldn't, I am wiring my kids to be conforming to whatever is being told to them. And when there is a time that the family and the church is not having influence on the kids, now there is a popular kid in school who is pushing the kids to do an inappropriate stuff, and they are, okay, then I will do whatever who is higher than me telling me. But when we work, when we don't mind that much about the behavior and the decisions, but work on the deep level, then here changes are happening. Why you are not changing? Because do this and you don't do this. Do this and you do not do this. I remember a guy entered church with a ponytail full of tattoo, and look, all the church is now looking to that guy, a very weird guy that going to the church and entering to take communion, and it was the eyes of that priest who looked beyond the external appearance that looked to the good in that young man. How much he has been thinking of entering the church, and it is very awkward, and he knows the Egyptian culture, and he knows how he will be looked upon. And it was very, very, very tough for him to make this decision just to be entering the church. And Abuna recognized this and told him, can I meet with you after you take communion? And this was the change in the life of that young man who later on cut his hair and later on removed the tattoos and later on has completely changed. The whole point is If you want to have a change, a quick change, you will always work on the behavior. Do and don'ts. Do and don'ts. But if you want a deeper level, you need to go in depth. I will give you an example. A young boy or a girl, they want to drink milk before taking communion. I'm going to drink milk. I'm very hungry and I need to drink. Don't tell me anything other than this. What is the easiest way? No, you are not going to drink milk. The milk is in the fridge and the fridge is off limits and that's it. We are going to go to church and you are going to take communion. Fine. If you want to go on a deeper level, what options you have? How you can deal with this to go in a deeper level? I will tell them what? If you want to take communion, you do not drink milk because you need to abstain from food and drinking before. But if you are going to take communion, if you are going to drink, then you will. If you drink, you will not going to take communion. And at least now I give him the options. Can you ask a deeper question about the identity? Who you are?
Generally, the practice means being in control of your body and giving up certain elements. And it's a practice for real life.
So, being in control of your body and giving up certain elements. This is what? This is a belief. Maybe because you value self-control. But I want to go deeper. This is really... Yeah, this is very good. So it is not on the behavior, so I went even more deeper. But if I asked a question, do you know that you are the child of God because you are calling God our Father who art in heaven? So if the child of God is having two options, which option you think he will make? Now you are going even in a deeper level of the identity. Very, very common question, we are going to Abuna, tell me what to do, tell me what to do, tell me what to do, tell me what to do. But the whole point is, ask yourself who you are and where is this aligning, whatever you want to do is aligning with your identity or not. I will end with a story. I was visiting a home, and this home, there was a lady that it turned out to be a daughter of a very, very, very famous Abuna in Egypt. And once all the people gathered knew that this young lady is the daughter of that famous Abuna, they kept asking her, tell us about Abuna. Tell us about him. Tell us about him. Tell us about him. So she didn't do anything. After 2 hours, we are leaving, and she said, I will tell you about dad. And in the lingo of a clergy, kids, when they say dad, it's different than when they say Abuna. If they say Abuna, it is our priest. If they said dad, then this is mine. And she said this. She said, when we grew up, we were maybe in the age of junior high, Abuna never told us no. He never told us no. Then I said, you know what, this is blowing my mind. I need to go in details. What did he tell you? So I asked her, I need explanations. How come he didn't tell you no about anything? She said this. She said, honest to God, he never told us no when we grew up a little bit. So what he was saying, he had this rule. The one who loves God will make right choices. The one who loves God will make right choices. We will not be able to put ourselves in the life of the kids all their life because we think that we need to have control on their decisions, on their career decisions, on the things that they choose and the person that they pick for marriage and so forth. We want to control every single aspect, hopefully. But this will never happen. But Abuna was visionary, really, because this happened many, many years ago. And he spoke to her about the belief, if you really love God, then you will make right choices. I'm not going to be with you all your life to tell you what to do and what not to do. It is your responsibility to identify who you are, to ask yourself what is your belief, and work on your values, and very simply, you will make the right choices for yourself. I will tell you, there is never ever a Bible verse that you will read and will sink inside of you and you will not change anything about what you believe in. The scripture goes inside of us, like 1 Corinthians 6:9. If I said, you know what, homosexuality is no big deal, it's the personal preference. Go back to 1 Corinthians 6:9, it says no. Because God is going to judge people who are making these choices. So, if it sinks in, and I'm accepting it, it changed a little bit of part of my belief, changed my values, changed my decision. For the sake of the time, I need to stop here. Do you have any questions?